like to start on time. So I have a couple of administrative requests. One is, could I request all of you to put your phones in silent, please? Sadhusan, please come here. Those of you who are sitting at the back, I urge you and suggest that maybe you can come and occupy the seats here. And if you think that wherever you're sitting that you want to leave earlier and you won't be observed, that would be a mistaken assumption. However, you can leave where you want, but you know, as I said, please come. We are having a few more people joining us. Well, I've got some SMSs and WhatsApp saying that people are differently delayed, but please come. Before we start and I welcome you formally, I just want to also add a little apology, which is that I just heard over the last few hours that some of you have received more than one email inviting you to this evening's lecture, and that it was actually referring to some of the Changing Asia series lectures that were held last year. And I was trying to ask my younger colleagues how this has happened. Now, this is off the record, but I gathered that the site of the SPS, the Society for Policy Studies, has been hacked. And we think it's a foreign hand. We have not been able to establish the identity. But we have put out a caveat in cyberspace to say that the SPS has a claim to fame that it's a small private think tank. And our claim to fame really is that we are the only think tank in Chittaranjan Park. So this is obviously causing some concern in certain constituencies. So anyways, but if you have received more than one, invite my apologies, it was completely inadvertent, we'll get to the bottom of it. But let me again, as I said, welcome all of you on behalf of the Society for Policy Studies and the Habitat Center to the Changing Asia series. Some of you have joined us at earlier lectures, and you know the spirit and the reason why we have embarked on this, and I want to thank the Habitat Center and Mr. Rakesh Makkar, the director, who's here with us this evening, for helping us to sustain this. And really, you know, at that time when we started, which is more than a year ago, it was to try and create a forum where Delhi could have the equivalent of a public lecture. That we needed such spaces and a platform where there could be the equivalent of a useful kind of deliberation, where discussions were constructive and we could identify themes and subjects and differences, even where they existed, it'll come up in the QA, were very, very collegial. And there was some space to be able to discuss big issues, complex issues, and frame them in some kind of an appropriate matrix or frame of reference. And we identified the Changing Asia series, saying that for a variety of reasons, Asia is going through its own changes, and that perhaps we could look at it from different perspectives. To the extent possible, we always try to relate it back to how does it matter to India? How is India affected by these developments and issues? And it's in that spirit or sense that we've been able to sustain these lectures. The feedback has been positive, generous, and that was what encouraged both the Habitat and the SPS to keep the series going. We do it every 2 months, as most of you are aware. And for the first lecture of 2017, I'm very glad that we've been able to prevail upon Professor Pratap Bhanu Mehta. Now, many of you here would have read him, I'm sure. He's a very prolific writer. He's currently the president and the CEO of the Center for Policy Research, which again, if you're not aware, is tucked away in a very nice part of Chanakya. And over the years, I have been in awe of this man, you know, because I first came across him very accidentally, I would say, in the early 90s. I used to be a young researcher at the Sapru House, where the Institute for Defense Studies was located. And this, for the younger generation who's sitting here, was what is called as the pre-computer age. There was no Google. There was no cell phone. So we used to carry index cards and go to libraries and look for journals, books, and try and write down notes and so on. And while doing some kind of a, you know, search for something, I came across an article by an Indian author, an Indian name. And Pratap, please correct me if I'm wrong, but this was the early 90s, 92 or 93. There was something in a journal called the Pacific Affairs. And this, if you remember, was India was coming out of a very, very turbulent political phase. The Cold War had ended. Mr. Narasimha Rao was yet to take over as the Prime Minister. And we had various changes at the very top of the democratic structure of governance in India. More Prime Ministers in a short period than we've ever had in the history of India. And there was this very, very, I would say, insightful kind of interpretation. Disordered democracy, if I remember right. It was a long time ago. And as I said, we were all young researchers at that time, and an international journal and seeing an Indian author. I didn't know who Pratap Bhanu Mehta was, but I do remember that, making a note and saying that in the post-sunset moments when you're discussing scholars and articles, you tend to sort of be a little more spirited. And I remember one term that was used for this man whom nobody knew at that time. The Hindi expression was, ye kafi top wala banda hai. And then it transpired that there were people who knew him and the family from Rajasthan, Jaipur, and various kinds of triangulations were made. And I said, hey, this is a person that I should read more and so on. So I was flagged at him. And then almost a decade later, I was still in the IHC, I had a very long innings there. A younger member of the family, studying in Delhi at a college, at one of our, when we met, was in complete admiration and awe of a lecture that she'd heard at the Lady Sriram College. This, for those of you who know NSR, was the Lutheran Memorial Lecture. Again, I hope I'm not getting against her. And guess what? Here is Professor Mehta, who, having dissected and given us his observations about India and its democratic disorder, apparently, I was not there, but I heard about it once removed. Socratic citizenship? Can you see the trapeze? And that's when I said I must know more about this author and this intellectual. I don't think he joined the CPR at that time. But by which time we were able to obtain writings, books, etc. And as I said, I remain in awe of Professor Mehta's prolific contribution. And for those of you who have not been reading him in the Indian Express or elsewhere, just for the record, if you go to the CPR website, you will get a detailed CV of the professor, which runs into 21 pages. And they're all publications, by the way. And here is a man who has been able to create one of the most fascinating trapezes, if I could use that word, in terms of ideas. And he's a man of ideas, if you read him. His original work, his PhD in Princeton, as I've just gathered, was on Adam Smith. And from there, he has made various transitions. He has addressed very complex issues pertaining to law and judiciary. He has delved deep into political theory and given it the equivalent of a contemporary interpretation. He has spoken, lectured, written on public policy. And he's also had a stab at the nuclear issue, post-98, when India had conducted its own nuclear test and what happened after that. And it's all been framed in the most, I would say, fascinating way, because my enthusiasm for ideas and my grasp of them is inversely proportional. And when in doubt, I read Pratap Bhanu Mehta. And when we were discussing in terms of saying that who would be the most appropriate choice, I said, if I had a wish list, I would identify PBM, those are the initials that we known by. And then it transpired that there is a sort of extended fan club as far as Professor Mehta is concerned, and everyone agreed that he's the right choice. But then the challenge was, how do we get him? He's traveling, he's speaking, and for those of you who are not aware, Professor Mehta is speaking at the IIC tomorrow, by the way. So let me make a plug for that also. I'm selling tickets in black for that. And the payment, as you know, we are now a cashless economy. So the payment can be in the form of cigars and thimbles of cognac. I hope the IIC will allow me to say this. But he's speaking tomorrow, and it's the George Varghese lecture, for those of you who may be interested, 6:30 at the IIC. So basically, my request to Professor Mehta was whether he'd find a window. And he was very gracious, and he was able to find a time. Vikram, please come. He was able to find a window and, give us the slot today. And then, of course, we were talking about what would be the appropriate subject, and I left it to him completely. I said that he could choose whatever, and this is the title, as you can see up there, Asia: Hope for the Future or Prisoner of the Past. I don't have a full sense about how he's going to frame it, but like you, I'm going to be sitting here and eagerly waiting for him to make his remarks. On that note, allow me to thank you once again, all of you, for being here with us this evening. Delhi is a happening place today. There are many things happening. There are four major events. So I do appreciate the fact that you have made this choice to be with us this evening. And I promise you, it's going to be a great lecture this evening. On that note, allow me to welcome and introduce you. Request you, Professor Mehta.
I must confess, that's absolutely the most embarrassing introduction I've ever received. I think it places a burden I can't possibly live up to, and I wish some of it were true, but I think it's more a tribute to Commander Uday Bhaskar's generosity than to anything I've done. I should also preface my remarks with one other kind of prefatory note, which is about this lecture. I doubt there'll be tickets selling for black. In fact, I think you'll probably ask for a refund some point during the course of this lecture. In part because the fact that I'm here is entirely a testament to Uday Bhaskar's persistence and charm. This is a subject where I'm frankly out of my depth, as I think many of my young colleagues from CPR, former young colleagues from CPR here will tell you. But he was kind and charming and persistent, so I agreed to take the plunge. So you hear me at your own peril. And I thought what we would do for this occasion, and that's really the spirit in which this is offered. This is not a settled argument by any means. I'm not sure in international relations anybody can offer a settled argument at this point in our history. I think there's so many multiple uncertainties. So what you can run is kind of scenarios under these conditions X, under these conditions Y. And that's the spirit in a sense in which these remarks are offered. It's really a kind of very big picture view of how do we frame, as it were, what the challenge is in this kind of transforming Asia. The last 30, 40 years have been truly extraordinary in Asia, I mean, at all levels, right? Asia has seen extraordinary economic growth, unprecedented in human history, actually, not just propelled by China, but more broadly. It has had a period of extraordinary peace, prosperity, and stability. It's been a period of deep cultural transformation. It's been a period where almost all the propitious conjunctures that you could think of in geopolitics kind of came together, you know, deep states, kind of leaderships that were committed to at least being prudent and not reckless. And as we realize now, that's a rarer event in history than we think. Global circumstances that enabled, I think, Asia to, and I'm using Asia just very loosely, we'll come to what Asia means in a second. Global circumstances that, enabled Asia to, as it were, prosper under a broadly liberal international order. And whatever we may say about liberal internationalism as itself a vital instrument in the maintenance of American hegemony, there is no question, right, that the way in which that order was conceived, right, allowed Asia's rise, in all kinds of interesting ways. And I think we are at that conjuncture where there begin to be questions about whether this conjuncture will last, right? Are the good times over? Are bad times upon us, or is there something kind of, in between? And I won't claim to answer any of these questions. I have absolutely no idea what the world will look like in the next 10 years. I think all we can say with certainty is that there is something transformative about our moment, which I think, and that transformative character of our moment is not just captured by what's happened in the United States. I mean, clearly that will cast a long shadow on what happens in Asia. But I think there are also deeper undercurrents in our own societies that suggest that many of the paradigms that we took for granted for the last 30, 40 years will be up for grabs in fundamental ways. Are there any structural drivers to those changes which you could look at and say, look, these structural drivers will take Asia in one direction rather than the other? There are obviously structural drivers, but I'm a little skeptical that those structural drivers will actually determine the course of kind of Asia. I think it'll be much more conjunctural and political, as I'll try and argue in the next few minutes, right? So let us first just look at kind of place Asia in a kind of big picture scenario. You know, what are some of the salient trends that you see in Asia? So just to give you a roadmap of what I plan to do in the next half an hour or so is, I'll first sketch what I think are some of the salient trends that are going to be the incontrovertible facts that shape, as it were, not facts, but trends. There's a difference between facts and trends that are going to shape Asian geopolitics over the next 15, 20 years. Then I shall talk a little bit about how we've been responding to these trends. And then pose a question about what is the big risk, right? What is likely to be the source of the biggest risk that Asian geopolitics faces that might derail, as it were, this wonderful party we've had for the last 30, 40 years? What is the nature and character of that risk? And you know, as you can guess from the title, does it come from our relationship to our own pasts? So at one level, right, I think we can say the following things with some degree of confidence at the moment. First of all, liberal internationalism, as we have broadly understood that term to mean, which is a global world or global and open world order, that while maintaining American hegemony and being an instrument of hegemony, American hegemony, allowed the progressive incorporation of lots of new and rising powers into a system of reciprocal dependencies and multilateral institutions. That era is probably coming to an end, or at least going to be very, very drastically modified. I'm just going to sort of stipulate that. We can talk in discussion whether that is indeed its main manifestation is going to be the fact that, as always, global politics is often a function of domestic politics. And the kinds of domestic politics that you're seeing emerging in the United States, I think, does imply fundamental transformations of the international system. I don't think what we are seeing in the United States in the rise of Mr. Trump is a epiphenomenal political freakish phenomenon, you know, one election gone a little bit wrong. I think it does represent, I think, a fundamental shift in the relationship between states and markets as we have conventionally understood it. If you look at the last 30, 40 years, there was a term that I think Philip Bobbitt coined to describe the emerging international order, which was market states, right? Where the idea was that progressively the states of the world will have to evolve not just in directions that resemble, as it were, market states, or at least respond to the imperatives of the market, but they would be situated in a global context of global markets, right? So if you think of the sentence we often use, you know, markets will discipline the states. Right? The idea was that there is some underlying logic to market behavior which states will by and large have to respond to, right? Creatively harness. They will be penalized or punished if they don't do so, right? And that your appropriate regulatory stances or the nature and character of the state will depend upon recognizing the subordination of the state to the market in some respects. I think what you're seeing in the United States, and Brexit, and Europe, and India, and China, is, I think, a fundamental attempt to reverse this relationship. And it's a fundamental attempt to reverse this relationship in one key respect, which is one of the problems of the market state, or challenges of a market state, was that the market state could produce, right, all kinds of instrumental goods. When the going was good, we all signed up for it, right? Market states are more efficient, market states will produce growth, market states will produce dynamism, right? But there was one interesting problem market states left unresolved, which is what happens to collective self-determination in a society composed of market states, right? Can politicians tell their people that their fates are now exposed to anonymous market forces? Even though those market forces might be delivering, you know, good outcomes, we'll do some redistribution at the edges, you know, we'll create appropriate regulatory policies to compensate for the losers. But fundamentally, right, the idea that economies are subject to collective self-determination and control, that idea is an illusory idea. Right? Now, this is a very old debate in economics. I mean, going back from the 19th century, Marx had this wonderful essay called Sanju's Illusion, right, which was really pointing to a fundamental contradiction in the ideology of the French Revolution, which is, on the one hand, you know, this was 18th century Europe, arguing for the rise of commercial society with extraordinary hopes that, right, commercial society in the interdependencies it creates, right, will herald a new era of peace. On the other hand, there is this kind of republican strain, right? And the republican strain is not so much about, you know, society governed by liberty, equality, fraternity. I mean, that's the most exalted kind of democratic expression of that republican strain. It is really about the fundamental idea, is your economy subject to political control or not, right? Or is politics going to always be subordinate to the imperatives of, as it were, markets, right? And I do think we are at a moment where the political pressure to now re-embed markets back into states, right, in a very different kind of way, right, I think is going. When Mr. Trump tweets at 3 a.m., I've got Carrier to do this, I've got Ford to invest this, I've got so-and-so to do that. The point of that is not, I mean, we can debate its economic logic, we can debate, you know, whether this is just a political stunt. The point is to actually demonstrate, you know what, there is somebody politically in charge of the economy, right? That re-embedding of the market state back into what you might call state market, I think is going to be a fundamental trend for the foreseeable future. And it has a lot of implications for Asia as well, actually, in Asian politics, right? So you will see reassertion of sovereignty over markets, probably more localization, more industrial policy in the old-fashioned sense, all of those things, right, that economists have told us the last 30 years have become somewhat passé. And again, this was the ideology rather than the reality, but that ideology did determine the course of politics and expectations. I think that's about to be fundamentally reversed. So we are going to an interesting phase where the question to ask is, what is going to be the nature of state-market relations? Right? And is that going to be fundamentally different from what we are seeing? The third thing we can say, I think, this is almost a kind of platitude, is all of this is going to produce immense economic uncertainty. I think there's no reason to be apocalyptic about growth. There is this big debate over secular stagnation, for example. And, you know, and that's a very conditional debate. I mean, I don't think even Larry Summers thinks it's overdetermined that there will be secular stagnation, right? But the two things which we know less about is what the relationship between growth and employment is going to be in almost all our economies. Right? Right now, the headline numbers don't look apocalyptic, but the nature of the relationship between growth and employment is certainly very, very fraught, or at least there's a lot more political apprehension about that relationship in almost every country that we know. I mean, the jobless growth debate in India, I think employment low, falling employment elasticity of capital in China, you know, there is an issue that seems to be politically very, very salient there. But the second thing that we do not, and I think we should state it, because my political scientist friends are often very confident about this, you know, well, if there is low growth, if employment elasticity of growth is falling, you will see a lot more political turbulence, right? That's kind of intuitive common sense. I'm just not sure what that relationship is anymore, right? Which is, what is the threshold of, let's say, unemployment? Or what is the threshold of casualization of employment? Or what is the threshold of, right? As it were, slowing growth, at which the economy becomes a political liability. I mean, I think one of the things we are discovering over the last couple of years, that we actually know very little about it, right? Moreover, even if, right, there is, let's say, not economic euphoria, but, you know, economic stagnation, slowdown, right, in growth, what will be the political channels through which political protest will be articulated, right? There's often a distinct possibility that what you don't see is actually major political upheavals. What you see is a bit more social pathology, for example, right? So the idea that, right, this economic uncertainty necessarily will lend itself to some kind of political change or upheaval in our political systems, right? I think it's an open question. I mean, myself tend to think these political systems will turn out to be quite stable. A, simply because they have the coercive power to be stable. One of the things about all Asian states, right? I mean, you remember the debate around Tiananmen in 1989, right? At the beginning of change, or about India. One of the things about our states is that, for good or for ill, they're all endowed with enough coercive power, right? And depth of institutional legitimacy that I think they can weather convulsive political change. I don't see that happening. What you will see is kind of, you know, as I said, protests that are splintered, perhaps taking a form of social pathologies, but not convulsive political change. So it's a very stable state system in that sense. Right? Finally, in terms of geopolitics, again, the most obvious platitude, China's rise is an established fact. Right? I think what there is also seems to be consensus on is that China seems to be moving from a stance of what the British historian Chris Hughes once called the transition from kind of pragmatic nationalism to what you might call geopolitical nationalism. Right? And the transition from pragmatic nationalism to geopolitical nationalism has three or four key elements to it. What is, in a sense, the difference? So pragmatic nationalism is really kind of associated with Deng, right? Which is the idea of kind of, you know, lie low and buy time, right? I mean, that was the kind of the canonical sort of narrative about China's rise under Deng. So this move from pragmatic nationalism to geopolitical nationalism, its key elements are, first is the enlargement of China's security perimeter, right? These days, Mahan and Mackinder are popular in every country in the world, once again, which I think is a very dangerous thing for the world, by the way, but, right? The movement, for example, for defining, you know, the South China Sea as now very central to, as it were, the security perimeter for China, right? Not just a kind of incidental legal claim out there. And the honest truth is, we actually don't know what the boundaries of the security perimeter is actually going to be. But the fact that it is going to expand, right, or has been expanding, I think seems to be a fairly obvious fact in terms of China's outward stance. I think the second element of this transition from pragmatic nationalism to geopolitical nationalism is the sense that the United States not vacating some space in Asia, right, is seen as a kind of sign of, or an attempt to marginalize China and confine it in its place, right? So just like we run our, you know, what is it, string of pearls narrative, China has its own string of pearls narrative about the United States, right? Which is very central to that geopolitical imagination. The third element is not just an expansion of security perimeter, but a more explicit articulation of the idea of spheres of influence, right? That redressing what China thinks as the unjust character of the global order, we can argue whether that's a self-fulfilling narrative or not, but you know, it's articulated as a version, does require somewhat carving up more space in terms of sphere of influence, you know, whether it's kind of division between the Atlantic and the Pacific, you know, those kinds of articulations, right? So there is very evidently that shift, as we said, from pragmatic to geopolitical nationalism, and the prospect of, I mean, the nice thing about pragmatic nationalism was that it allowed geopolitics to be much less of a zero-sum game than geopolitical nationalism does. Because geopolitical nationalism immediately takes you from kind of pragmatic accommodation to use that old-fashioned term, somewhat a struggle for primacy, or at least parity in some kind, right? Which requires greater adjustments in not just the existing power, right? And the transition from pragmatic nationalism to geopolitical nationalism is also fraught with uncertainty, because it's, you know, it's an interesting moment where you might say what great powers do is try and engage in price discovery, right? Let us push the boundaries of our security perimeter. Let us push our ask of what our spheres of influence should be. And let us insist, just as a show of strength, that the rules of the world order, right, cannot now be as unilaterally articulated as they were before, right? And often this is done, you might say, not with a kind of malicious intent. I mean, and that's why you always have this disjunction between the power's own presentation of what it is doing and the way the rest of the world perceives it. It's simply a form of price discovery. You know, let's try and see what we can get away with, right? And the counter response to that, right, it has to be politically very nuanced. It has to be politically very nuanced in the sense that, on the one hand, it can't give carte blanche. It can't say just because there's a rising power, you know, you get to define your security perimeter which way you want. You get to have whatever sphere of influence you want, right? Or that you, in a sense, get to define the rules of the international order whichever way you want. So, you know, that obviously is not on. On the other hand, right, the concerted response cannot also be one that sort of reinforces the sense of marginalization and victimization, right? That this quest for geopolitical nationalism actually feeds on, right? And I think one of the reasons there is, I think, a lot of uncertainty about this is that, you know, when you're engaging in price discovery, right, I mean, this is not a perfect competition market, right? It really depends on very delicate judgments about where that mean point is, which satiates both that geopolitical nationalism on the one hand, right, where a power can say in terms of its national identity that we have achieved some kind of parity, right? We have got more recognition now in the global system than we previously had, right? What's that sweet spot which says you can satiate that, right, without, as it were, giving in? And I think that sort of, I think, you know, you might say reaction and counter reaction is likely to continue for a while. And as I said, it's precarious in one very specific respect, because the chances of misjudgment kind of sort of, you know, increase, right? So this is one kind of moment in that great power politics. In terms of Asian economic integration, then I'll sort of come to kind of what I see as the challenge. Let's kind of do a sort of very quick stylized account of Asian economic integration, right? Obviously, the integration is often fueled by or propelled by the dominant power in the region, right? Because it has the economic clout to, in a sense, restructure economic, political, institutional relationships. The first wave of economic integration in Asia, right, generally was done through the aegis of Japan under US hegemony, broadly speaking, right? I think there is a fascinating account to be written of the role of Japanese ODA in kind of integrating Asia over the sort of years, right? But by and large, it was a benign form of integration in the sense that Japan was itself a Pacific power because of the particular history of World War II and the subsequent relationship with the United States, right? By and large, it was a engine of economic assistance and kind of locking countries into technological project chains that remained relatively independent of interfering with or having implications for internal power relationships within the countries they were actually engaged with. Right? China, in a sense, as it comes to supplant, Japan is one of the big engines for kind of economic integration in Asia, right? At least in Asia, begins off with a story that is relatively organic, right? And in fact, one of the reasons China kind of enjoyed such untrammeled legitimacy actually in Asia was, for decades they ran trade deficits with the rest of the world, trade surpluses with the rest of the world, but trade deficits with, most of the neighbors in Asia, right? It was a form of Chinese industrialization where many argue that many of the supply chains were still outside China, so you kind of integrated, into Asian supply chains significantly. What many people are arguing, I think, is that what has changed over the last few years, it's a gradual process, there's no pivotal moment, but a process that's underway that sort of shifts the momentum, is that the nature and the instruments through which, right, China now kind of propels Asian integration, right, is going to be somewhat different. And it's going to be somewhat different in the following respects. First of all, I think it's an interesting question that if you take my kind of state market hypothesis seriously, right, we are back into the era of kind of industrial policy, make in India, make in China, make in America, make by US, all of that stuff. And I would not underestimate the power of that. I know economists and people who do actual business are skeptical of it, but politics has a strange way of kind of taking over, right? It's not entirely clear why that would not entail, and has not already begun to entail, actually kind of relocating a lot of supply chains to China itself. Right? And in fact, if you see the kind of China's trade with the rest of Asia, it's very clear that those extremely benign days, right, where China was this kind of, almost a kind of benign trading partner for most of Asia, are actually over. Right? What you have instead, as a kind of compensation, right, is a kind of integration to infrastructure, right, which is one belt or one road, that entire sort of architecture of infrastructure. And in some ways, I think infrastructure suits China's strategy for a number of reasons. First of all, I think it is its signal contribution to development theory. I think on this the Chinese were right, which is at least more right than most of the World Bank and IMF were ever throughout their history of doing development. That infrastructure actually does matter to development. Right. I mean, if there's a kind of signal contribution to practice development theory, I think that element is actually quite important. But and obviously infrastructure at one level, one of the nice things about infrastructure is if you ask the question abstractly, who can be against infrastructure? Our security establishment is, in its fundamental paranoia about. Basically, the security establishment doesn't care about economics as much anyway. But in a very abstract way, right? I mean, who could say that, more ports, more roads, all that connectivity that actually would enhance productivity and mobility is necessarily a bad thing, right? And in fact, once you have the infrastructure in place, the pressures to actually produce mobility, at least use it, arguably increase. I mean, I'm putting it in the most naivest way possible, but you can see the kind of the intrinsic attraction of that infrastructure. Arguably, from a Chinese perspective, right, it is also about access to markets. There's no question about it, and a way of kind of directing sort of investment, right? Now, the challenge of this kind of propulsion of Asian integration, right, is that I think infrastructure, the conditions under which this infrastructure is going to be built, right, are somewhat opaque. They're somewhat opaque in the sense that, A, unlike a lot of the past trade and infrastructure relationships in Asia, it's not clear how much of an economic logic lies behind propelling this infrastructure development. And certainly in areas like ports and stuff, you could probably see a glut actually. I mean, I'm just trying to imagine Sri Lanka with Hambantota, Trincomalee, with India doing all its ports. Is it really a kind of supply side driven story? How much of it is actually based in, right? Anchored in. A kind of organic economic evolution is not entirely clear. Second, it's not, as many of the countries are beginning to worry, right? The actual terms with which this infrastructure is coming. I mean, the Indian security establishment worries about the infrastructure because it gives China access to all kinds of things. I myself am actually very skeptical of those worries. I mean, A, you probably can't stop being built anyway. And I think the economic logic of infrastructure in our neighborhood will probably mean that, in the end, right, you can't fight geography sort of that much. I would worry more about, right, the terms of what it does to possibly the economies of the countries in which it is built, right? And it's clearly the case, for example, with Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka is finding out, right, with Hambantota, numerous examples of it. This infrastructure is not coming cheap. Not only is it not coming cheap, it can possibly, in a sense, entrap those countries into payment commitments that may not be economically optimal. And finally, the worry about this infrastructure, particularly if you're looking at smaller countries, is that it really does have the potential to somewhat become a significant factor in the domestic politics of those countries, right? Do Sheikh Hasina and do Mr. Rajapaksa at some point say, in the short run, this is amazing infrastructure, there's money to be had, stuff to be built. I mean, infrastructure is actually electrically very attractive, to be honest, right? So you settle for terms that have lasting implications on actually political configurations within those countries, right? In a way that was probably not true of, let's say, Japanese ODA or, right, those kinds of things, right? So you have this, in some ways, I think, you might say slightly ideologically turbocharged integration happening, right? Which many perceive as being driven in a sense by both a development vision, but also in a sense consistent with, right? China's positioning itself in the space of, as I said, geopolitical nationalism rather than kind of this pragmatic nationalism, right? Now, how do we respond to all of them? What are some of the likely scenarios? So to be honest, do I lose sleep over this evolving world, right? Many of my colleagues, even in CPR, do sometimes. This is an extraordinarily dangerous world. This is China exercising unprecedented hegemony. China will gobble up Asia. I honestly am not that concerned. I mean, I think this is at least in the way I kind of want to. I mean, I'm concerned in a particular way, which I'll just come to in a second. This stuff is not only kind of inevitable in some ways, but I think the interesting question is how can you potentially harness it, right? Keep the Asian story going, because there is a case to be made that a deeper and greater integration of North Asia, Northeast Asia with South and Southeast Asia is probably going to be good for not just us, but probably the global economy, right? And all kinds of arguments you can run about kind of demographic matches, those kinds of things. And certainly if you're looking at for some drivers of growth, this relationship may actually turn out to be far more consequential than maybe, for example, the India-United States relationship. There's an argument to be made, that's the right? So intrinsically, it's not a kind of, you know, worry, I mean, if it's properly handled. As I said, the real issue is whether these right kind of judgment calls in this mutual price discovery can be made, right? So Mr. Trump's apparently calling the Chinese bluff. China is apparently calling his bluff. Let's see how this game unfolds, right? What is my big worry about this, right? That's the central question. So all of this stuff, right, as I said, Asia has had this remarkable kind of period in the last 30-40 years. And one of the central characteristics of that, right, politically, as I said, was that it gave almost all Asian countries, right, in some ways, not just a new narrative of hope, right? I mean, this general idea that things are going to get better. I think that was a very startling feature of our imaginations in the last 25, 30 years. Right? And one of the things it did, and this I do want to say, because there is a lot of kind of debate about the relationship between globalization and nationalism. I think in Asia, more broadly, the last 25, 30 years, right, it certainly allowed us to sublimate our nationalism in significant ways. So long as you could run some kind of story that India is getting better, arriving on the world stage, China is getting better, arriving on the world stage, I think it took the edges of our nationalism. My big, not worry, let's put it this way, the core question to me is, I think if you looked at it purely in terms of external relationships, right, which is, can the US and China mutually adjust? You know, some friction, but enough, right? There's probably reason to still be cautiously optimistic. I mean, you know, one of the things we have, it's an interesting fact about the world now, so that none of the big powers, right, have liked committing troops to death in a big way. I mean, America has fought big wars, but again, it's tried to fight wars without actually, you know, suffering mass casualties. And I think it's an interesting, you know, to ask Atal Bihari Vajpayee's question, right? Which he apparently asked, you know, when there's this great clamor to send Indian troops to the Iraq war, you know, jab pehli lash aayegi to kya bolenge, right? I think we underestimate the degree to which that has actually been a kind of default common sense in a lot of Asian countries, that politically selling conflict, right, of the kind domestically politically selling conflict, of the kind that would involve, right, serious risk, troops and violence, right, there's been a great deal of admirable reticence on that score, right? Basically, we were, as it were, not itching to fight, right? I mean, that's. Now, the interesting question to ask is, under what conditions might that change? Right? I mean, that's, I think, I would argue, and this is really the last submission I want to make, is that just as I said, China has made this transition from pragmatic nationalism to geopolitical nationalism, the interesting question to ask is, how much of that geopolitical nationalism is actually going to be tied to a domestic legitimation story inside China? To my mind, nationalism, I'm totally cynical about this at this morning, you know, look, nationalism is a modern religion, it's the only ideology that can conjugate death, it's the only ideology that gives meaning to people's collective existence. I think the need to have a kind of historical community that persists in time, I mean, all of those things we know, right? I mean, you know, nationalism is the kind of incontrovertible route to modernity, right? But, right, I do think at this point, increase in nationalism is in a sense largely driven by domestic political concerns and the need to find a new legitimation narrative. Now, if you look at the three Asian powers kind of competing in this space, right, there's a lot of debate about, for example, Japan's rise of nationalism in Japan, when Mr. Abe is described as a nationalist. I'm actually a little cautious about coming to a judgment on Japan. I still think that despite, obviously Mr. Abe has an interest in, kind of, like all nationalists do, in rejigging the education system and so forth. I think it's still too premature to conclude that Japan is actually becoming more nationalist. I mean, I think the data, for example, on anti-Chinese, anti-Korean sentiment varies quite a bit by context. I mean, in that sense, it's, you know, so it's not in a sense a kind of underlying stable fact. I think the very fact of geopolitics, I think Japan does have a dilemma, which is, the dilemma is, if the Chinese-American relationship is very bad, then Japan's in a bit of trouble. If the Chinese-American relationship is very, very good, there is a version of that good relationship, right, that could actually sort of marginalize Japan, right? So in that sense, I think a reasonable sort of debate, right, about the transformation of Japan's historic commitment to its Pacific constitution is a fairly sort of genuine response to a substantive institutional dilemma. And I don't see this as a kind of rise of, you know, a new nationalism and kind of bilingualism. Right? China, the honest truth is, we don't know. Right? I think what we can say with confidence, and this is the worry, both about China, and I will say this about India as well, that's the last point, is that the one thing that, right, I think China is going to struggle with, and in a sense that's part of this geopolitical kind of narrative, like the United States, is the legitimation narrative for the state is no longer going to be that obvious. One of the interesting things I think we've learned from Brexit and all of these things, right, is that purely instrumental justifications for any form of political community, right, whether it's internal, right, building a nation state, or whether it's for regional integration, has actually severe limits, right? It has severe limits in the sense that it actually doesn't become part of your identity and not kind of internalized. So why should we be committed to this Asian order, right? Just to make some money, it's not going to cut it beyond a point, actually. I mean, it's a cardinal political fact that happens to be true, right? I think right now there's this attempt to kind of, as I said, fuse that grand nation narrative, right, with a kind of form of narrative about China's sort of arrival at the world stage, in the hope that not just that delivers economic goods for China, right, by way of investment and market access, but actually creates a new kind of legitimation narrative that strengthens and shows the power of the state, right? I think India, to be very honest, has a similar challenge, right? I think it has a similar challenge in the sense that, like China, like Japan, like India, one of the downsides of the erasure of the left-right distinction that happened as a result of the hegemony of, you know, market states, right, as we call them, right, where there's, you know, the end of history logic, right, there's basically one kind of economic logic you have to conform to, at the margins you can tinker with it, is that the only ideological fissures you have left in its wake, right, are fissures between varieties of nationalism. You know, so one of the paradoxes, for example, people often ask is, you know, why is the debate over historical memory, right, much more pronounced now, let's say the Japan-Korea relationship, Japan-China relationship, than maybe it was in the 1950s and 60s, right? Now, as I said, a lot of explanations for it. But I think one of the possible reasons also, right, is that when you have a kind of ideological vacuum, where politics is not constructed around left or right in that conventional sense, right? You're likely to see political contestation mostly around the axis of aggressive nationalism versus some other form of nationalism, right? And if that is the main ideological axis, if you have a kind of competitive party system, right? And it was interesting that Mr. Abe, in his own limited way, in opposition, kind of raised the nationalist card. He's been much more measured in office. The insertion of nationalism as a central axis of domestic politics, right, that possibility increases dramatically. Right? And I think that is what you're seeing in India in dramatic ways. I think China for very different reasons, right? And could possibly be mobilized in Japan as well if the external situation, right, deteriorates. Now, the problem with nationalism, right, is twofold, and that's the biggest risk, is one, most forms of nationalism that we know of in Asia, right, even in homogeneous societies, are going to extract an immensely divisive internal cost. As we are seeing in India, I mean, there is something truly extraordinary about a ruling establishment that can be shaken by one 20-year-old girl student. I mean, don't underestimate. This is not a mild cultural phenomenon. Mr. Rajnath Singh is not shaken by 2,900 CRPF men being injured in Kashmir. Hasn't spoken a word, really, right? What's going on here, right? Potentially, remember China, same thing. I mean, it has, Tibet, Xinjiang, right, that whole, right? So there isn't a form in which one can see that nationalism being articulated. As we're seeing in the United States, that is not internally divisive. But most importantly, whenever nationalism becomes a bigger issue in domestic politics, it cuts down that power's room for international maneuver. Just to take two quick examples, what was the problem with our breast beating after the Uri strikes? Right? Forget the factuality of those strikes. Forget the, whether previous governments have done it or not. That's right. Central problem most sensible politicians have grasped is that the more you raise expectations of what you can do as a power, the more your hands are tied in international affairs, right? So there was something useful politically, actually, about saying, we don't do much. Actually, we did a lot, but we said we didn't do much, right? Because the next time something happens, it actually paradoxically gives you the space for, our feigned weakness was a very astute political strength, right? Because it allowed people to not be so confident next time something happens to stand up and say, oh, but we have the capacity, oh, but we did it last time, right? Now, once powers begin to inflate those expectations, which is really what kind of geopolitical nationalism does, right? India is also doing it in its kind of bizarre way. Our problems, our words are louder than our actions, right? We are going to become an Indian Ocean power. Seriously, Indian Navy taking on the Chinese in South China Sea? Come on, right? I mean, this is not a kind of denigration of the Indian Navy. It's just a realistic assessment of what's in our interest to do or not, right? That we are in a political cycle where those expectations are, I think, now inflating to a point where they could potentially tie our leadership's hands in unprecedented ways. Right? Now, that makes both the process of adjustment very much more risky, right, than it would be in a kind of normal transactional story you give with some users, right? Once you have declared your security perimeter to be X, once you have declared your capacity to be able to strike something, then not doing it, right, domestically much more And I said, in competitive politics, the pressure to then, for some party to say, why aren't you doing it, increases. Now, what's the, you know, what's the underlying challenge? The underlying challenge, I think, which we have to frankly ask in Asia, right? This is the one question we don't ask in Asia. We have all the brilliant strategic analysts and all that. The one profound cultural fact underlying all this that makes this possible, right, is the fact that our historical consciousness and identities are still profoundly shaped by what happened to the region in the 30s and the 40s, right? Whether it's Japan, Korea, China, Japan, India, Pakistan, right? A kind of mutual constitution of identity, right, that has not been able to come to terms with and develop a new shared memory around what actually happened. Right? So if you're thinking of a new architecture in Asia, right, whether an architecture of values, an architecture of security and whatever, right? As I said, last 25, 30 years, it happened under the American umbrella. There was this great talk about new Asian values. Remember ASEAN kind of going on and on about, you know, new Asian constitutional order. Well, turns out that constitutional order was very fragile in two ways. Not only was very fragile in the sense that it has broken at the slightest hint of great power politics, right, that kind of ASEAN consensus building, but I think it rested on a denial of one very destabilizing fact in Asia. So one of the central elements of an Asian consensus was we are all sovereignty powers, right? One of the things we don't like about the hegemonic West is, you know, internationalism in an interventionist sense, we respect each other's sovereignty, all of that stuff, right? Fine, it's, you know, probably a safe doctrine to hold on to. Except that the material and cultural construction of nationhood in almost all our countries is very deeply implicated with the history of Dalit. Right? I mean, forget India, Pakistan, just see India, Myanmar. Right? Tomorrow, if the Rohingya problem explodes, right, it is a geopolitical event in the region. Right? It will involve Bangladesh, it will involve us, it will involve the Chinese. Right? And Asia is, in a sense, kind of, you know, that's the real stream of pearls in Asia. Now, if you get circumstances where divisive nationalism increases, right, you can hold on to the sovereignty doctrine all you want. But we are in a situation where, you know, a history textbook written in some other country becomes a geopolitical issue for.
Please identify yourself, you have a mic.
So you have given the name. Mr. Chair. Sir, there was one, before you were at Dignity, Dr. Manmohan Singh, he also said he won't lose sleep. Do you want to compare yourself with him? You have referred to market states. Well, the basic thing, the market states, whichever way you want to put it, they have not been able to eliminate poverty. That was the fundamental point of the market economy, which it did not address. Whatever may be the reason. Now the next question, putting it very simply, do we have to go from minimum governance to maximum governance because this has failed? Market economy has failed, so we have to go. Forget about putting it in a nationalism manner. Infrastructure creates job employment. Even Donald Trump wants to spend $1 trillion in renewing his infrastructure. I'm sure you know it. You didn't mention if Russia, USA and Russia come together. Thank you, sir.
I'll take two or three questions at a time.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
You have a mic, please identify yourself.
See, historically,
sir, please identify yourself.
My name is Beni Prasad Agarwal. I am a former ambassador of India and also presently chairman of an NGO called Association for Asian Union and Asia-Pacific Cooperation, which was founded in 2001 and expanded for Asia-Pacific Cooperation recently with a view to expanding democracy in Asia, because we came to the conclusion that the key to an Asian Union is progress of democracy in Asia. Now, my question is actually that the two major issues confronting Asia today are the lack of secularism in a large number of countries and the lack of democracy in one of the major powers of Asia. Can there be any progress towards an Asian entity or Asian body unless these two issues are resolved?
Thank you. Dr.
Pratap Bhanu, recently, Dr. Sarabjit Dudeja. Recently, President Donald Trump tried to be very closely with Taiwan president. Do you think he is trying to balance Taiwan in comparison to China? Do you think it will be some effect on China economy?
That's a very good question. So,
first with the secularism and democracy question, I think I'll reframe it in a slightly different way. I think right now democracy doesn't have a huge ideological kind of name to it. I mean, I think that ideological vacuum will also be felt for quite a while. And I think, you know, actually may open up sort of, you know, interesting possibilities. I think in Asia, I would say I think three things, which is in almost all countries, the central conflict now is not the, there's the religion secularism thing, but I don't think that's the main story. I think that's an epiphenomenal story. I think it is the contest between forces of individual liberty and forces of authoritarianism, more generally, right? And it can manifest itself in different ways, in obviously authoritarian regimes, the struggle for political participation, but it is also increasingly manifesting itself in democratic regimes. The balance of power in terms of the relationship between individual state is decided, I mean, it's always been with the state at one level. The state would crush anybody who wanted. That's what states are, right? Monopoly of violence. But I think states are acquiring new and insidious powers in ways that are actually unprecedented. So that battle between liberty and authoritarianism, and I don't think it's necessarily just a battle kind of between democratic systems and authoritarian systems. It's a fault line that in different ways runs kind of, you know, within them. Secondly, and you know, I think this is one of the interesting paradoxes of Asia is that at one level you have a young generation that has seen, you know, extraordinary expansion of personal freedom in some ways, right? I mean, both in terms of the choices they have. I mean, there is, for want of a better word, an extraordinary cultural revolution in a sense, you know, underway. And there will be forces of orthodoxy, right, trying to suppress it. Secularism is not as much an issue in the sense as much as nationalism is. Because even religion works as a politically potent force only when it is aligned to nationalism, right? And in that sense, I mean, you know, any form of nationalism, right, that enhances the power of the state at the expense of individual liberty, right, I think it's going to be in the long run dangerous for the foundations of that democracy. And I think we need a new different political and cultural vocabulary to sort of talk, you know, about this. The question of market states, you're right, sir. There is a political perception out there. We can agree or disagree whether it's exaggerated. I mean, I think one of the big lessons of the last 4 or 5 years is how little we understand about how actual economic realities translate into political perception of those realities, right? Yes, the median wage worker in the United States wages have been stagnant, but is the American economy, did Obama leave it as bad as it would produce such a populist backlash? It's actually not entirely clear that that is indeed the case, right? And moreover, even if there is economic discontent, would you vote for people who kind of sort of, you know, cut off your nose to spite you? So I take your central point, which I perfectly agree with, which is that we are also at a moment where there is a perceived crisis of legitimacy in the form of market capitalism that we have experienced. Now, some would argue that this was not genuine capitalism, that its problem was cronyism, all of that. But certainly there is a political legitimacy crisis surrounding this. And that's why I said exactly the common thread running to all of these countries is, therefore, the economy must be politically controlled in some ways or another, right? So I agree with your point. The losing oversleep, I mean, Manmohan Singh was a lot more consequential than I am, so his losing sleep actually made, you know, different. But I meant losing sleep, you might say, was put flippantly, but I actually do think, and particularly in our certain parts of our security establishment, it's a very complicated, I think, beast. I think the biggest mistake we can make is to give into a politics of paranoia too prematurely. It's in contrast with that, that at least on this kind of economic, you know, sort of front, I'm not that worried. And in fact, I think we should also kind of learn a lesson, you know, in the sense of that, you know, a lesson or two. I mean, our problem is we're not a big player in the infrastructure space, right? And as much as we pretend we're not going to be, both in terms of the financing we offer and our capacity, I think we are, for example, at great risk of losing all the gains we've made with Bangladesh over the last 3 to 5 years. I mean, it's a very pivotal moment. You had that political opening, you're losing it. You had that opening with Nepal, you're actually losing it, right? And what our security establishment has done is kind of converted this into an argument about sort of, you know, I think paranoia is more a kind of alibi. So it's in that sense that, you know, on this kind of, let them build the ports and the roads and the bridges. I mean, you know, I actually do think in the long run an organic economic logic has to kind of underlie that. And we should have enough confidence in Sagi to be able to mobilize it. Russia, we can talk about at length. Again, two questions about Russia, which is one big lesson. Russia did not make the transition from geopolitical nationalism to pragmatic nationalism, right? And you could argue maybe that's in part because Mr. Putin still needs it for a kind of, right? Now, what the objective function is of Russia, right? That is not clear. I mean, we know a few things. Obviously, Russia wants sanctions lifted. When we say a Russian-American accommodation, what are going to be the terms of that accommodation that Mr. Trump can send back home, right? Is it going to be to concede to Russia the spheres of influence that it wants, right? Forget Ukraine, Georgia, Estonia, right? I'm not entirely convinced Mr. Trump can sell that domestically, right? Because that has been part of the American national narrative so deeply, right? It's not entirely clear even in West Asia, right? So I think right now the game is going to be at the margins to restore some kind of dialogue, and I think Mr. Putin obviously would want kind of the overturning for sanctions. But I don't think it's a foregone conclusion that there's an easy accommodation to be made, right? And again, it illustrates the point, which is part of the reason there is a foregone conclusion, it's easy accommodation can't be made, is because once you move from pragmatic nationalism to that kind of geopolitical nationalism, right, then that accommodation becomes harder. Because you have points at which you just have incompatible versions of what is a legitimate sphere of influence.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Mehta, I have two. I'm Ravi Chaudhary. Two observations I'm trying to grapple with. One, the subject. To me, it appears that the prisoner of the past and hope for the future are not mutually exclusive. And it was brought out quite clearly in your very stimulating narrative that while Japan, Korea, and China, in their interrelationship, were less prisoners of the past, and therefore were able to grow faster. So that gives very little hope for us in India. We are somehow stuck in a stationary time capsule, not only of 30s and 40s, often beyond in social norms. We refuse to change ourselves and disengage from what is history, we believe history as we know, culture as we believe we know, that we are destroying our own hopes for the future. How do you, I'm unable to come to terms with it.
That's a very powerful question, and I actually agree with your simple point. I think that's the only thing holding us back, to be honest. You know, it's like a little poison that sort of infects everything else in some ways, right? It has held us back in the region. We'll continue. It actually distorts our democracy, that fault line, right? The fact that we've not been able to come to terms with it in profound ways, right? I mean, it's still playing out. You just have to watch UP election speeches you sometimes kind of, you know, read text from the 1930s and survive, or in 2016 we're still playing the same script, even if in a kind of coded, in a sense coded way. And look, nationalism and great power politics is all about a kind of underlying moral psychology. It's the sole source of insecurity in our underlying moral psychology, right? I don't buy our strategic establishment's belief that the road to Pakistan will come through Washington or through Beijing. It may not come otherwise, but I just think India-Pakistan is not an international relations problem. I mean, you know, they are two states and should remain two states, right? It really has to come around understanding and coming to a sort of shared narrative around, okay, 47 happened, and you know, those barriers were created. They've allowed us, right? I mean, I actually think partition was not only inevitable, arguably partition was actually liberating in a certain sort of way. But the fundamental conflict which, you know, in different ways both of us are grappling, right, is what I said, which is you had an imagination of the subcontinent as a federation of communities, right? Now you have to convert it into a kind of zone of freedom, right? Which is the route into this will have to be a consensus. Look, we can debate history to death. I mean, it's a, why a little discovery in Harappa transforms our sense of self, I have no idea, right? But the core issue is, in all our societies, right, the central social cultural fault line, as I said, is between forces of freedom and forces of authoritarianism, right? And if our societies internally have a consensus that we all stand on the side of freedom, the problem of identity actually gets resolved automatically. Because you're giving an assurance that every identity will nobody will be targeted for being who they are, right? Which is the biggest source of security every citizen can have, right? Simply being who they are. You're giving the assurance that all kinds of identities will flourish because we're protecting basic freedoms. And that's, I mean, frankly, that's the commonality, right, on which you can actually emancipate yourself from the past. Right? What you can't emancipate yourself from the past by actually having a historian's debate over and over again. Right? I think the India-Pakistan dialogue should be a human rights dialogue. We should be, you know, I mean, we are British. I mean, you know, I mean, just look at our voting record in the UN Human Rights Council. I mean, it's actually, you know, for a, one thing we don't realize, you know, our biggest asset in Asia has got to be now our institutional strength. Therefore, whatever our problems, this is not an opaque political system, right? That is the strength we want to run away from. Rather than saying, okay, there are limitations to it, there, you know, that can be the only basis for a shared future in South Asia.
I'm sorry, you know, I promised a few people saying 8:30 would be when at least I would turn into a pumpkin, because some people said they have dinner commitments and otherwise. So I don't normally do this, but Arvind Chopra and others who have identified themselves, please bear with me for today. So this has been a fascinating, I would say, presentation lecture by Professor Mehta. And I want to thank the audience. You know, I had made a lot of notes and said that is it possible to sum this up, but I shall not do so. But it just struck me saying that not a single phone rang. We had no disturbance in the course of the 45-50 minute lecture that Professor Mehta had outlined for us. And I want to thank him because, you know, if you think about what he said today, at one level, it's a very complex formulation. But he was able to present it in a very lucid manner. And I did notice that we have a lot of younger colleagues here today, some who are aspiring civil servants, some who are in academia. And I look forward to your written, shall we say, summaries. Because that, by the way, Pratap, was the, you know, discussion we were having over tea. I was encouraging them to write down whatever they felt and come up with their own critique. And I just want to flag a couple of, you know, broad points made by Professor Mehta, where he spoke about this question of the mutual contestation of identity in the larger Asian context and cited specific examples. It was not just South Asia, India, Pakistan. He spoke about East Asia, Japan, Korea, China, Japan. And the lack of a shared memory, or perhaps an agreed memory, and the need to at some point reconcile or harmonize what you might call as competing narratives. And sometimes, you know, the elision of memory, the need to forget. At which point that's going to enter the discourse, I think, remains very, very a big question mark. Mr. Chaudhary's question, I think, points to that. But it just struck me as I was listening to Professor Mehta that this is a very, very, I would say, appropriate kind of run-up to August of this year. In August 2017, we are coming to the 70th anniversary of 1947, which again would be differently remembered, differently recalled. I don't know if it will be celebrated in that celebratory sense, but definitely I think institutionally it will call for a lot of reflection. And I want to thank you, sir, for in many ways, I would say, setting the stage for many of us here to think about these issues. And in conclusion, I do want to sort of place on record and thank the Habitat Center and Mr. Kakkar, who's here, the director, for his continued support for this Changing Asia series. I want to thank members of the diplomatic corps who are here. I recognize some of the universities in Delhi and the NCR who have sent their representatives. I think it's a very good sign for the Habitat and the Society for Policy Studies that we're able to increase our footprint. And members of the media who are here. As always, those of you who are inclined to and are able to share your thoughts in a more focused way, please send us your email IDs. We have a couple of young SPS reps over here. We have Chaya, and we have Sharza. Please leave your email IDs and take, you know, our ID from them. And if you are able to turn in your 700 words, that's our maximum that we can accommodate. in the next few days, we'd be happy to set up a small discussion group about what was discussed today. And if it leads to something more substantive, we'll circulate it to those of us who are on our mailing list. So on that note, I promised you 8:30 we would close the session today. Professor Mehta, may I, sir, thank you again for this extraordinary lecture.